Hello, it's Jason Heath again with Contrabass Conversations, solo show number 4 of 6 here in March 2019. And we're talking tech today. And looking at these 6 outlines I made, I thought, am I talking about too much tech? And then I sort of realized, well, you are listening to a podcast. You might assume that I am into technology, and I am. And I've been using it for teaching for as long as I can remember. I remember back in the very early 2000s, or maybe even the late 90s. Yeah, it was the late 90s even too. Having a duffel bag full of crap, basically, you know, like a giant stack of photocopies, half of them were ripped or torn, a bunch of Zimmerman books and my solo literature and my orchestra tuning piano parts for various things and all that kind of stuff. And then an extension cord and a power strip, and I'd plug all that stuff in. I'd plug in my video camera, which I would carry around like a maniac. I would plug in my Dr. Beat if I hadn't lost the AC adapter, which constantly happened. I would plug in my tuner, that my drone. I even had a decibel meter and all this sort of stuff. I would set it up. It would take me like 15 minutes to set up in a practice room because it was just I don't know why I would carry it around, but I did. And I would bring it to where I was teaching. Once I got the iPod, that was like a revelation. I took all the music that I used for teaching and I tried to make MP3 practice tracks for all that. And I brought on portable speakers. And these days, you probably see where this is headed. These days, I'm looking at 2 devices here on my desk in front of me. One is my iPhone. The other one is my iPad. And during teaching and during my own practice, I have an app loaded up on each one of these. On the iPhone is Modacity, my favorite practicing app, the one daily companion to both my teaching and my playing. And on my iPad is an old but classic and constantly evolving, and I just love it, love it, love it, app forScore. So forScore on the iPad, Modacity on the iPhone, and that's what we're talking about today. I've also, like with many of these that you've been hearing over these 6 episodes, if you've been listening, thank you first. And I have been presenting at some conferences the last few months about these apps and about this topic. And additionally, I wrote a blog post that I have linked to called How I'm Practicing Music Better Using Modacity and forScore. So I talk through all of that there and kind of just give you that whole spiel that I did. Okay, so why am I using these 2 apps and how do I use them? And I will, let's start with forScore. Okay, so I've got my iPad Pro here. And I always got iPads through my school teaching jobs. I was lucky in that that was just one of the things that we would get as a teacher. So I never really, I bought the very first iPad the very first day it went on sale. I was so into the idea of this device. And then I never bought another iPad in my life until this 2018, I think, iPad Pro that I have in front of me, maybe 2017. The school jobs, I just had whatever iPad 2 or iPad, I don't even know what generation. And it was fine for reading music. I would use it in my lessons, but it was always a little small. And I never really fully invested in forScore. I knew it was there, but there were some other apps that kind of were like PDF organizers that I thought was good enough. I never really got it. But the moving to, and then I was cheap when I moved out of the Bay Area because I had, well, understandably, I like left my job and we were moving to the most expensive place in the United States. And I thought buying over $1,000 electronic device for something I might be doing, I wasn't sure if I'd be doing a lot of teaching or not, just didn't seem like a prudent move. So I waited, and I had in my mind the way I wanted to use the iPad, which, by the way, I am now doing, but I had no iPad. I had my first iPad, because I had to give my school iPads back. So I had my, 20, whatever year it was, 2010 maybe-ish, that the first iPad came out. And I quickly realized, this does not work well in the modern world, because it is too old. So I kind of gave up on that. finally, I got a gig at the beginning of 2018. Yeah. So I booked it in 2017 and I said, okay, that gig is going to pay for the iPad. It was about the same amount of money that I was getting. So I went at the end of 2017 and I bought the iPad Pro and I got the Apple Pencil and I got the keyboard case. And that has become my main computer. I use that thing more than I use my laptop. I'm not as fast on the iPad, but I am in some ways more creative on the iPad, and I use it. I mean, I got to use it at least 5 hours a day. I'm sure I'm using it 5 hours a day. And I just went totally hog wild in terms of forScore. I now have thousands and thousands of scores on there, both for conducting gigs. I have scores, and then I have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of bass ensemble pieces from the fabulous library of Inez Weyrich, John Kennedy, among many others. I have every piece I teach and play. I have it all categorized. I've gone through, and I have correctly titled the piece, put in the composer, put in whether it's, I use the genre I'm trying to set this up so that I can use it the way I want to use it, which is what I love about an app like forScore. So I tag things into what I'm actually going to use. I really need to find bass ensembles for different levels of students quickly. And so I have things in duet, trio, quartet, quintet, sextet, septet, octet. I don't think I have anything beyond that, but I have all of that. So they're tagged up in there. I have things in keys, and then I have difficulty levels assigned, and there are only three difficulty levels, and they're strictly for my use in terms of trying to find music for students. So anything even remotely challenging is a three, but I try to make sure but on a scale of 1 to 3, 1 being easy, 3 being challenging, 1 is stuff that I could give students year 1 of playing, which I need to find that stuff a lot. And then 2 would be, still in bass clef, maybe a little treble clef in the top part. 3 is anything beyond that. So that is my categorization. Then, and that's just my kind of raw library. I'm looking through here, and what else do I have? Difficulty key rating. I do rate things sometimes, but only if I don't go through and rate everything. I only rate things. I kind of use the rating as like a bookmark. I rate things I like, and it's generally just student ensemble music that I'm rating. I don't rate like the Modacity concerto, 4.5 stars. No. It's just for students. So then I have built a series of playlists that I find extremely effective for the way I work. So here are, or set lists rather. Playlists are for Modacity, but set lists. So my set lists, I have one that's just called Current, which is what I'm working on right now. Hey, curious on what I'm working on? Let me tell you. Sturm, 110 studies. I'm on a kick where I'm doing one a day. I am on number 59. And I've been doing those for years and years. I don't know. I just associate them with practicing. So they're a good way for me to get going. I then have Can't Stop Running by Adam Ben Ezra, A Walk in the Woods by Lloyd Goldstein, Nicholas Walker's Beautiful Chorale, Alexander Murayev's Alice in Wonderland. And I discovered that at the Latin American Bass Festival this past November. Andres Martin's Solo Sonata. Then I have Stroken by Hal Robinson, something I've been working on for years and years. Barry Green passed along Andres Martin's Anna's Promise Fantasy. I've been working on that some. It's a challenging but ultra cool, and I want to play that. Then I've got Lloyd Goldstein, This Little Light of Mine, Lloyd Goldstein, Let It Be. Love you, Lloyd. David Hayes, Il Marinin, which he wrote for me, dedicated to me. Thank you, David. I've been playing that several times the last couple years. Then Boardwalking, Hal Robinson. Then I have this plan to record George Vance's Progressive Repertoire Volume 3, do videos for those. I did videos for Volumes 1 and 2, and those have proven to be useful for folks. I want to do Volume 3, but as I did Volume 1 and 2, like, I got the idea and did them all in one day. And then I was going to do Volume 3, but I was, first of all, tired. And then second of all, I thought, I should probably practice before I put all those out. So I have been actually trying to practice and do that. Then I have Diana Gannett's ridiculously useful orchestra excerpts book, which is up on the blog, doublebassblog.org/music. I will link to that right now as I'm talking. Then I have Sueños Andres Martin's beautiful dream suite. Bill Harrison has been putting together some really cool etudes, so I've got those in there too, which I play occasionally and use with students. Then some bass ensemble music that I just want to look at myself. Danny Zeman's great books, Topics in Jazz Bass and The Lowdown. We've talked about those on the podcast before. Killer Walking Bass with Tamer Fell. Also talked to him about that book. Patterns for Jazz, Jerry Coker. I've been using that since the 90s. Love that book. The Ebersold Preparatory Exercises, that page one thing. And then Ray Brown's Jazz Double Bass Method. Just for some jazz teaching I've been doing. No big deal. So that's my current list. I will not do this for every list. Then I have folders. I have a series of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 folders. Within the folders are set lists. So current is there. Then my folders are upcoming events, helpful lists. And for me, helpful lists are easy bass ensembles, Lloyd Goldstein pieces, and George Vance progressive repertoire pieces. Then I have private students. Each private student has a set list that I build. And then school rep lists, which I'm constantly using for the coaching I'm currently doing this year. I have one of these schools, Marina Middle School. I have 57 items in there. When I go in and coach, they have some piece that they're doing. I snap a photo within forScore of that, and we're good to go. I write the students' names on the part, on the different lines if they're doing an ensemble piece, so I can remember, because I'm always running around like a chicken with my head cut off, and I have no idea whether that this is the Raymond's group or whoever's group. And what I do in forScore, someone hit me to this after I put out a video describing how I use forScore and I wasn't doing this. You can have layers, like in Photoshop, you can have layers of annotations, of marks on the score. So now when I'm working on one of Inez Weirich's pieces, which I've done several of them like over a dozen times, I just create a new layer and I can write the new students' names and this and that on there. And then I can always call up an old layer. So if I'm working on the same piece at two schools, which I try not to do, but it happens. And certainly if I'm working out of some teaching pedagogical rep that I do with everybody, I will have the same exact student, or the same piece done by every student, you know? So I want to take some notes and be able to write in fingerings as needed and write things for them. So I do that on the layer, and then I only have up the layer I really need. So school rep lists are really great. And then past events is super useful. So upcoming events, and then, I mean, this is, makes sense. Then after it has been upcoming, it goes into past events, which is really useful. So I can go back and see, what did I do at Golden Gate Bass Camp? What did I do at the Latin American Bass Festival? What did I do with that concert I just conducted? And that is how I keep all this stuff organized. I think I maybe mentioned this on this one. I maybe not, but I conducted for the first time. I did a conducting gig on the iPad. And then when I was down at the Texas Music Educators Association, TMEA, I asked the directors there who used the iPad for conducting, and a lot of hands went up. A lot of high school band directors, a lot of middle school directors are conducting off the iPad. I found the experience great. And though you can only see one page, you know, I guess you can turn and you can see two pages, but it'd be smaller. There's something really reassuring about looking down and having that one page be in the exact same spot on the conductor's stand. And I can record rehearsals right there on the iPad. I record in Evernote and listen back and see how things are going. I can take notes right there on the iPad. I find it an incredibly useful device in all ways. And then when I'm teaching, like I was just teaching a lesson before I hopped on the mic here, working with my student, we got done. She has the music we're doing, but we were writing on my iPad. So I just did a screenshot of that and I just texted it to her, and she was going to go home and just mark her, in her part, the things to take out in terms of rests and that sort of thing. For other students, I'll just print out that page with the annotations or email them that page with the annotations and send it right to them. It's totally awesome. We are going to thank our sponsors and we will be right back. This episode is brought to you by D'Addario Strings. Our friends at D'Addario want to help listeners change their strings safely and efficiently, and they have a few tricks to help you achieve that.
What happens if strings aren't quite the right size for your instrument? For instance, if you play a 5/8 bass, when strings are slightly too large for an instrument, the tension will be lower. And when strings are slightly too high for an instrument, the tension will be higher. Learn more at orchestral.didario.com. And thank you so much for sponsoring the podcast. At Upton Bass, there is no B stock in terms of wood. Here's Gary and Eric from Upton on what happens when they encounter a flaw in the wood.
Rather than someone just looking at that piece of wood and saying, man, I got to throw that in the fireplace.
Yeah.
They go, my boss says I got to get this thing done. So they set that neck.
Yeah.
And we've just learned over the years, if a piece of wood, if you got to question the piece of wood, it just goes in the dumpster.
Yeah, just get out of there.
It's reasons like that that make Upton such a hit among bassists worldwide. They have an army of raving fans. I'm one of them, by the way. And they just make wonderful basses. Whether you're just starting out and you're looking for an entry-level instrument or you're looking for the top-notch bass of your dreams, they will work with you throughout the process and get you an instrument you will love. UptonBass.com is the website, and thank you so much for sponsoring the podcast. This episode is brought to you by Steve Swan String Bass. And Steve travels far and wide here in the Western United States. Here's Steve on where he goes and what some of the benefits of being able to travel like that are.
You travel with it. You're going up to Oregon. You're going up to Seattle.
Yeah. You know, and back, you know, out to Arizona, you know, wherever people want to see a selection, they don't have options, or if I have a line on some basses I want to check out and maybe buy or trade, you know, I have the option. That's the beauty of me not being tied to a workbench in a shop.
Steve works with some of the San Francisco Bay Area's best professional bass luthiers, people like Nathaniel Rich, Alex Friedman, and many others, to get basses playing beautifully. When someone comes to me asking where to look for a bass, whether they're a student or a professional, or they're coming through town and they want to try out a great selection of basses, I always send them to Steve. Learn more at steveswanstringbass.com. And thank you so much for sponsoring the podcast, Steve.
Whenever anybody's going to the Midwest, and I lived in Chicago, Illinois for years and years, I tell them to go to A440. If they're looking for a bow, if they're looking for a bass, if they need some repairs done, if they have a student who's looking for an instrument, A440 has been serving the community for years and years. They're located just west of Wrigley Field in beautiful Chicago. They do great work, and they've been a big supporter of bass events over the years, whether it's the Chicago Bass Festival or really any bass event. A440, you guys rock. Check them out at a440violinshop.com. This episode is brought to you by the Bass Violin Shop, which opened in 2001 as a small double bass workshop in Greensboro, North Carolina. Today, they're staffed by 3 full-time, highly skilled bass luthiers, and they specialize in double bass sales, rentals, setup, restoration, and repair. For nearly 20 years, they have satisfied thousands of clients by offering quality instruments, knowledgeable service, reliable repairs, and superior restorations at affordable prices. Did you know that they regularly ship basses nationally from coast to coast? Contact their team to find out more information about the shipping process and how you can get your dream bass delivered to your doorstep. For more information and current inventory, visit their website at bassviolinshop.com and be sure to follow them on Facebook and Instagram. Okay, we are back, and that was a bit about forScore, which I love, 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 love that app. Haven't really talked about it on the podcast. This next app that is on my stand all the time, I'm looking at it right now on my iPhone, I have talked about it on the podcast. It's Modacity. I've had CEO and founder Mark Gelfo on the podcast, but I'm obsessed with this app. I love it, and I love that people are discovering it. Micah Howard, who hosts the Pittsburgh Double Bass Symposium, of course, Pittsburgh Symphony member, Carnegie Mellon, bass faculty, and iDoubleBass creator, which is a super cool app. I will link to that. You should definitely get that. This app is just such a useful app for both teaching and playing. And the thing that I love so many things about it, I don't even know where to start, but it's a great suite of tools for practicing that are organized in a way to develop better practicing habits, more mindful practicing habits.
Let me walk you through my interface. And again, I have a video of this so you can see all this in action, but I have my recent practice sessions. So I open this up. I've got my welcome, Jason Heath, your progress, my total hours, how many days streak I've had, which sadly is zero right now. You big loser, Jason. I try to have that be more than zero. and then how many improvements I've made. And we can talk about that in a moment. And I definitely talk about that with Mark. But I have recent practice sessions. And like with forScore, I have a list called Current. That's a playlist. And within that playlist, I have the following things. Tune, rosin, get set. Essentially, that's my warm-up. Then I have Sturm Etudes, Can't Stop Running. You hear some overlap between that list and this. Goldstein Tunes, Nicholas Walker Chorale, Alice in Wonderland, Andres Solo, and then Stroken. I've been ending and starting with technique, which is kind of interesting. This practice list is what I call an open practice list in that I work on an item for as long as I feel I need to, and then I go on. Modacity tracks the amount of time I have been practicing and logs that for me. It also asks me to give a rating after I finish everything, and that's really interesting because it allows you to sort all of your practice items. So your items are like songs, and then you organize them into playlists. Just think of it like iTunes or Spotify. And I found it really useful to sort and see what do I think is going well, and even better, what's not going so well. And you can also sort by when did you last practice this? And then you can get this great bird's eye view on your practicing in general, what you've been doing that week and over time and all that kind of good stuff. So this is an open practice list because I could practice an item for 30 seconds or an hour. I also find it very helpful. I haven't been doing that recently, but I have done it to build a timed practice list. So instead of just the clock ticking up from 0 seconds up, I say, like, I'm going to do this for 5 minutes. I'm going to do this for 10 minutes. I'm going to do this for 2 minutes. I also like putting in a minute of deep breathing, like a meditative minute. And you can build that in right there. You can build a break in. I'm going to do this, take a 5 minute break. I'm going to come back to this. The app will remind you every 50 minutes to take a break, though I do think you can turn that off, and you can set a notification to remind you at a certain time every day or for the next day or however you want to organize it to practice. Very, very cool. And then I think one of the things I love the most about this app, let me just open up Sturm Etudes right now. Okay, so that's going. What do I see? I see a timer ascending or descending, and I see the image of a microphone. That is such a brilliant setup because that microphone button, I want to press that button. I want to press that button right there. It's just calling out, Jason, record me. In fact, we'll do it right now. Here, let's record. Hello, I'm recording. Okay, so there we go. I recorded myself, and it's just that easy when you're playing bass or you're playing whatever. And I went from never recording myself, never, even though I had all the tools to do it, never recording myself, to recording myself multiple times a day for short bursts. Sometimes I save them, sometimes I don't. And I have this thing on the stand in all my lessons, my private lessons too, for many reasons. First of all, it's got a timer so I can see how long we've been going, which is great. Then that recording button, having that right there, it's a very non-threatening, easy way to get recording built into the lessons. And I've had zero resistance with students. Sometimes when I would pull out the recording device, people would clamp up or they'd get weird or whatever because, you know, no one really loves listening to themselves. But there's something about having it in this app, in this form, in this user interface that just, it just works. It's just awesome. Then at the bottom, you have, if you're using the app, all these great buttons. I'm going to start with the one on the left, which is the improve button, the mindful practicing button, or I do believe it's called the improve button. So I click that button and it says, what one thing, one is in italics, what one thing will you improve now? And I can choose from a predetermined list or write my own thing in. So the list is notes, consistency, emotion, technique, ease, rhythm, tone, phrasing, enjoyment. And it's an interesting list, isn't it? Let me check rhythm. Okay, what strategy will you try to make this improvement? You can add your own or you have the following four. Play with the metrodrone. Oh, I'm getting tired. I'm losing my ability to pronounce. The metrodrone is just what it sounds like, a metronome and a drone built into Modacity. Very useful. so that's one option. You sing the rhythm, slow down, or higher standard for precision. You choose one, and what comes up, it says play with Metrodrone, and there's a button for the microphone. It says start recording while trying your strategy. So, and then at the bottom, it says be deliberate, stay focused, mindfulness. And you record, and when you're done, it says, did you get the improvement you wanted? Yes or no? And then you answer, and then you can have the option to do it again or not. This is an excellent way for, I picture like a flow chart, right? You're teaching students, or you're encouraging yourself, however you want to look at it, to go through these steps, the steps of mindful practicing, of really focusing on what you're doing. And what this app does by focusing on recording, this app does many things. It's a brilliant app. Mark's a brilliant guy. I love it so much. But what this app does is it separates the analysis from the performance. Key concept. We do not want to be analyzing our playing as we're performing. We want to perform while we perform, and we want to analyze that objectively in a detached way, and we want to correct course and think about what we've done, and then we want to practice that again. And that is the way to eliminate, perform, or reduce, or manage, however you want to say, or build a stronger foundation, eliminate or reduce performance anxiety, and build a stronger technical foundation, a stronger self-confidence foundation, all the good things this app does. So great. You can take notes, and I highly encourage that as you're listening back or when you're working on something, and they come up like little cards in the bottom of that practice item. You can create, you can turn on timers that are kind of like subroutines within that one item. Oh, it's so great. I love this app so much. I can't wait to see this thing grow and develop. I dug deep into Modacity in a recent clinic for the Texas Music Educators Association, TMEA, their conference a couple weeks ago, and I got some great feedback from those teachers and what they wanted. So a few things that they suggested were was a teacher edition. How great would it be to be able to send out playlists directly to students? How great would it be to have students be able to submit recordings right to them, or to Google Classroom, or all sorts of things like that? Video recording was something that people were interested in, which is definitely in the works and is coming. It's audio right now, but I know that Mark and the Modacity team are working to make that happen. So many great ideas for this app. I'm sure that they would love to hear your experiences if you've used the app. Modacity.co, link in the show notes. Check that out. And forScore, I mean, come on, they've been around. They came out so early. I think that they were out within the first few months of the iPad, but it was like the perfect thing for the iPad. And forScore, my Apple Pencil, my AirTurn pedal, and my, oh goodness, however many hours I spent inputting all that stuff in there. Oh, I don't know, shudder to think about it. But it's all in there now. And once it's in, it's like the next level of music. I can't imagine going back to paper. You know what happens now when I use that stinking iPad and forScore so much like I do? When I go to regular paper and I want to write something in, I take my fingers and I try to pinch zoom in. I try to zoom in. You know that zoom in motion you do on your phone or tablet? I do that on paper. What's happening? I can't believe I'm doing that. But it just, I guess it just goes to show how used to that, how in my workflow that is. I also have the problem because I use that iPad for everything. When I'm at the laptop here, I'm constantly touching my laptop screen because I think that I'm going to be able to move things around. So maybe I just have issues. Anyway, we've got one more solo show coming your way. Thank you for listening to these. I know it's out of the box in terms of the podcast, but hey, that's what this podcast is. It's not like I haven't experimented before. So maybe these have been fun for you, maybe not. They've been fun for me. I don't think I've ever done this many solo shows. I'm not used to just talking in my office for hours, like I've been doing recording these, batch recording these. But stuff that I'm passionate about, I've been presenting a lot. I've been writing about them. I'm going to do some more videos about them. I'd love your thoughts and perspectives. Feedback at ContrabassConversations.com. Thank you to the team at Contrabass Conversations, Trevor Jones, Mitch Mooring, Krista Copper, Steve Hinchy, Michael Cooper. So great to have you all on board and making this podcast happen. I'm your host, Jason Heath, and we will see you again soon for more life on the low end of the spectrum.